Our first speaker this morning is Dr. P K Nair. Dr. Nair is a distinguished professor at the University of Florida. He is world renowned for his knowledge and his leadership in the area of agroforestry and sustainable land use systems. In fact, Dr. Nair was one of the founders of ICRAF and the World Agroforestry Centre in Nairobi, Kenya. So please join me this morning in welcoming Dr. P.K. Nair.
Good morning. Thank you very much for that nice introduction. It's indeed a pleasure and a privilege for me to be here this morning. Thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity. I have had, I would say, some long-standing connections with ECHO. See, look at the tie that I'm wearing. This is, I don't know if you remember this. This is an ECHO tie that I bought in one of my visits to ECHO. I think it was about, 15 or some years ago, when Dr. Martin Price, my friend Dr. Martin Price, was the chief person here. He and I worked together on an activity that we are conducting in the University of Florida called the Center for Subtropical Agroforestry. He was on the board of directors of that for some time. I don't know if I saw his name somewhere in the program. I don't know if he's in the audience. Oh, pleased to meet you. Okay, so this morning I'm asked to talk about this topic of increasing smallholder resilience through agroforestry. I have been talking about and I have been breathing agroforestry all my life, all my professional life, I would say, for the past more than 40 years, starting with my early work on this multi-species combinations in my native part of, southern part of India, and then from there on to the establishment of ICRAF, the World Agroforestry Centre in Nairobi, Kenya, where I worked for about 10 years, before moving to the University of Florida 29 years ago, actually to date, because I started in the University of Florida on November 15th of 1987. So it's a very appropriate time to be, an anniversary date for me to be here. I have been working on teaching, working on supervising graduate students and trainees and professionals and collaborating with various people around the world in the academic developments of agroforestry. So when I was asked to talk about this this topic of resilience, brief introduction was very eloquently given this morning by the person who talked before me, from poverty to resilience. So that sort of has set the stage. So what exactly is resilience? See, we in understand. Please pardon me. I come from the academic side of things. That's what I have been doing all my life. That is not in separation from or different from what many of you are doing in the field. I am very much a field-oriented person. My research and development activities have all been in the application side of things, not in making computer models and that sort of research. Not that they are not important. So I am very much a field-oriented person, but the work has had to be limited to more academic side of things. So in ecological terms, we talk about resilience as the ability to, or the capacity to persist and absorb changes. And in ecosystems, ecosystem terms, it refers to the stability and capacity of tolerating disturbance and restoring itself. It's a sort of dictionary type of definition, but that is very, it's very important for us to understand that. So when we talk about transferring or moving from poverty to resilience, I would submit that we need to go further. That's a passing state in my thinking, poverty to resilience, but we need to move forward to poverty to maybe plenty or whatever. So resilience is important, but how we can use that resilience to achieving greater heights, that should be the motto in my thinking. So this disturbance, when you talk about recovering from disturbance could be caused by various things like stochastic events which are random, which cannot be predicted very easily, like fire and flooding and windstorms. We get notices about this thing maybe sometimes a few hours before they happen. Sometimes, you know, in some situations like earthquakes and all that, we get no notice at all. So these are very random events. But then there are lots of disturbances caused by human activities. These are not random things. We deliberately do these things. So these are the things that we need to look at and see how we can overcome the damages caused by this sort of human activities. By human activities, I mean agricultural activities, forestry activities, or deforestry activities called deforestation, fracking for oil exploration, introduction of exotic plants and animal species that lead to pollution, natural resource mismanagement, biodiversity decline, anthropogenic climate change, and that sort of things. So there are lots of things that are happening around us in terms of disturbance caused by human activities. And these are the things that we are focusing on here. And particularly the last one that I mentioned, the climate change caused by anthropogenic reasons. So resilience is important to all of us, but it's particularly important to the smallholder farmers. A lot of talk, descriptions have been made about smallholder farmers. So what exactly do we mean by small farm and smallholder farmers? There are two terms, small farm and family farm. They sort of are very clear, but the first one, the small farm, is a relative term. Small and big are relative terms. So what is small in some place may not be small in other places. I'll show you some data on that. The terms are often used synonymously. But family farm, I think it is less confusing because it's owned and operated by a family. And it's the basic unit of agricultural economy in much of the human history, and it continues to be so especially in the so-called developing nations. But when you come to small farm or smallholder farm, it's a more subjective term, as I mentioned, and the focus of small farm is on the farm size, whereas in family farm, it's only ownership of the enterprise and the control of the farm. So that's a fundamental difference between these two. But this is important. An estimated 2.6 billion people produce more than 70% of the world's food on more than 500 million so-called smallholder, and here I'm using it synonymously, smallholder or family farms. So let me repeat that, 2.6 billion people around the world produce more than 70% of the world's food on more than 500 million smallholder farms. These are not my make, I haven't made up this one. It is well documented based on detailed studies by the FAO, the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations, and CIRAD, the French Development and Research Organization. So these are the global statistics. So look at these figures. When we talk about small farm, now, how do we get the pointer here? Can somebody show me how to use this as a pointer? I should have known that.
This one. It's a laser.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So when you look at, I want you to look at those numbers there. See in Africa, the average size of the let me quickly go through those columns there. The first one is agricultural land in millions of hectares, number of farms in millions and small farms in millions, and agricultural land in smallholder size and millions of hectares, percentage of agricultural land by smallholders. And the last column, the average size of small farms in hectares. So it's about 2.2 in Africa, or across Africa. There are lots of variations within Africa. And in Asia Pacific, it's 1.6. And I have put in parenthesis India there, 1.8, because it's a highly variable, very heterogeneous country, because in some parts of India, the small holdings are, where I come from originally, it's very really small. Less than half a hectare. Can you imagine? Well, some of you work in Haiti and all that, so you can imagine that sort of holding sizes. But in other parts of India, which are more semi-arid and arid and all that, the holding sizes are larger, as is the case in Africa. In Europe also, it's believe it or not, there are very small holding sizes in Europe also. It's more relatively more populated than we are here in the U.S., North America. In Latin America and the Caribbean, it's fairly larger, 9.7 hectares. North America, look at that, 67 hectares. That is a small farm. So that's what I said earlier. The small farm is a relative term, okay? Globally, they say 2.2 hectare is the average size. And now I jump quickly into the thing that I mentioned earlier about when you talk about resilience, we talk about resilience to the events caused by human activities that contribute to the change of climate. This is a graph which variations of this you may have seen in different places. This basically it shows these are self-explanatory. The top line is the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It has crossed 400 parts per million. And the bottom line, the jumping line is the what's called the climate temperature anomaly. Anomaly means variation from a standard. The reference point is listed there. That's 1951 to 1980. So with respect to that average, what's the variations happening in the temperature? And a higher value shows the higher temperature. Basically, that's what it means. These are all very well documented data from NASA. There is no question about this one. Okay, the question that we hear often is that what causes this one? But as far as the actual temperature rise that is happening, there is no question. And a lot of people, scientific people, attribute that to the increase in the concentration of the so-called greenhouse gases. When you talk about greenhouse gases, they are primarily, that's carbon dioxide. There are also nitrogen compounds, nitrous oxide, and all that, and methane. These are the major so-called greenhouse gases. Why are they called greenhouse gases? Because their effect is very much similar to what would happen in a greenhouse situation. Everybody knows, for example, in a greenhouse, the temperature could be high if there are not enough ventilation. So that is exactly what is happening in the world today. Considering the large Earth, we receive solar radiation in shortwave radiation onto the Earth's surface. Some of it is absorbed by the materials on on the planet's surface, Earth's surface, and most of it is radiated back into the atmosphere. But when the concentration of these gases, like so-called greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, the concentration goes up, that heat is trapped inside. That does not go back into the atmosphere. And so that's why, like in a car that is kept in sun, it gets heated up. So the planet is getting heated up. There is a direct relationship between the increase in the temperature, in the carbon dioxide concentration, and the temperature. This is what we talk about, the greenhouse gas effect and global warming and all that. And we need to, when we talk about this thing, we need to talk about in the context of the economy context. Because that's one of the fundamental difference lies in this approach. Because ecologists believe that economy is a subset of the environment. But the economists don't think so. The economists think that the environment is a part of the economy. This is the fundamental difference in approach to addressing these issues. The ecologists believe that all economic activities, indeed life, depends on the Earth's ecosystems. Whereas the economic theories, they don't explain the economy-driven destruction of Earth's natural systems. Many of the destruction that is happening in the natural systems is economy-driven, okay? And the economic theory does not contribute to that destructive type of approach. Now, in ecology, we recognize limits, constraints, and cycles. See, we talk about nutrient cycling, water cycling, carbon cycling. Cyclic processes are very important in maintaining the integrity of ecosystems. That's a very fundamental principle of ecology. But that is not the case in economics. Economists always talk about graphs, linearly, sometimes curvilinearly, but they never talk about things cycling in the system. So that's a fundamental difference. So when we talk about ecological deficits, we mean we are taking, we are not borrowing, but we are taking from maybe future generations, and that's the fundamental principle of sustainability, a much used term, but relatively less understood. Economic deficit, what we mean is here, we are borrowing from others. We are borrowing from each other, okay? Now, in the case of ecology, we are not borrowing, we are just taking. So if there are deficits, we just take it. So we take it from future generations. So the fundamental concept of sustainability is that you meet your own requirements, you meet the resource demand, use the resources for your own purposes, but also ensure that you don't compromise the demands of the future generations. Okay, that principle is not well conceived in the economic theories, and that's the difference between the ecology and economic viewpoints. And there are several examples of ecological cost of economic development. For example, food shortages caused by environmental destruction have undermined ancient civilizations. In Sumer, the lower valley of the Euphrates River in the Near East, in the 5th to 3rd millennia BC, crop failures caused by rising salt levels in soils due to a flaw in the irrigation system that has led to the decline of that empire. Now, relatively recently in Mexico, Central America, the Maya Empire collapsed in 2000 BC to 600 AD. That was a flourishing civilization, as some of you may know. It collapsed. How? Why? Because forest clearing led to soil erosion and loss of soil fertility. So the reason for the collapse of the Maya Empire. So these are the this is the price that we had to pay for the economic development. The ecological cost that we inflict upon the ecosystem, we just don't recognize. There are no clear ways of measuring that impact. And it's a very major, serious problem. So these declines can be traced to one or two damaging environmental trends, but today we have to deal with several. If you look at the technological innovations in agriculture starting from the 18th century, agriculture began, when you can see that there are several stages in the development of agricultural economy, so many types of things. I suppose everybody can read some of the small print listed there. So this is just showing the type of major activities that we have been doing in agricultural development over the millennia. Okay. So if you go to the extreme right, so these are the technological innovations that have happened in agriculture over the period of several centuries. I was reading the various things that are listed there. Let us come to this 2000 on. This one, the biotechnology applications, agroforestry, no-till farming, integrated nutrient management, integrated pest management, carbon sequestration. These were the main things that happened during that time period. Then conservation agriculture, micro-irrigation, precision farming, perennial culture, genetically modified organisms, GMOs. Then the next stage, sustainable intensification, or SI, soilless agriculture, urban agriculture, sky farming. These are some of the things that are happening, or technological innovations that have happened or happening in agriculture. So, has science helped in these developments? This is the main question that we had to ask. The experience of the Green Revolution is very fresh in the minds of many people. So, relating to that, we can say yes. Well, has science helped? Yes, of course, science has helped. Indeed, science has helped a lot in advancing agriculture. The Green Revolution, for example, is a very good thing that happened in the later part of the last century, until about let's say 2005. Green Revolution was the major thing in agricultural development, and remarkable progress has been made in enhancing food production. Poverty and hunger and malnutrition has been eradicated to a large extent in many parts of the world, thanks to Green Revolution, the miracle varieties of cereals, rice and wheat and all that. They have wonderful things have been accomplished. There's no doubt about that. Better seeds, more fertilizers and other agrochemicals, irrigation technology, improved implements and machinery, better infrastructure and marketing, institution of enabling policies, all those things happened to make Green Revolution a big so-called success. So that happened during the, let's say, from 1970s to early 2000, 2005, around that time. That is a big agricultural revolution that happened during that time period. So science has really helped in these things. However, there are also some side effects, some relatively costly side effects, I would say. Eroding soils, declining soil fertility, advancing deserts, pollution of the environment, diminishing biodiversity, increasing disease resistance of crops and animals, and then wrecking the climate, widening the rich-poor divide. So many of these problems that came, that ensued, it became apparent, evident actually, in the later stages of Green Revolution, because in the early stages of Green Revolution, people were all very excited about the yield increases that we were getting. They didn't have the time, they didn't bother to look at any of these things, and some of these things were not very clear in the early stages. But as time passed by, some of these problems became more and more clear, and people started paying attention to some of those issues. Now, the problem is that modern industrialized agriculture looks very good because it measures its own successes very narrowly, okay? And it ignores the costly side effects. So these side effects, that some of which I mentioned here, they were sort of ignored, bypassed. And that was the main problem that we have to now endure coming out of the Green Revolution successes. So that is how what we call ecological agriculture is very, very important, because feeding the world sustainably requires that we protect the ecological resources that are essential for producing food now and in the future. There is no question about that. The resources of soil and the climate and the basic resources, they need to be maintained. They need to be, even if you are not able to improve their productivity, their status, we should at least maintain their status, the food producing capacity of these resources. And there is no doubt about that. Statistics show that environmental harm caused by industrial agriculture cost the world $3 trillion each year, including about $1.8 trillion in cost from livestock production. This is the estimation of the, these are the estimates of the FAO as recently as last year. So we are paying a huge price, okay? But then there are questions, okay, how do you estimate these things? How do you, are they realistic? There is a lot of discussion among ecologists. There is also this this branch of ecological economics. Hardcore economists sometimes don't completely agree with some of the calculations made by ecological economists, but this is an important thing that is developing now. So these are the estimations based by scientifically trained, professionally trained economists. So using sustainable farming methods is not a choice, okay? It's a necessity. We cannot continue agriculture that disregards its very basis of soil, water, biodiversity, et cetera, et cetera. These are the fundamental natural resources. Any farming system, any technological development that undermines these basic resources, they are not going to be sustainable. And we have seen that from our experience with the Green Revolution. To feed the world while also confronting the climate change, we need policies, incentives, and investments that promote ecologically sustainable, diversified farming systems focused on smallholder farmers. Why smallholder farmers? Because we have seen that 70% of the food in the world are produced by the smallholder farmers. So we need to tailor our agricultural development technologies to cater to the needs of the smallholder farmers, and we need to develop technologies that can be adapted by the vast majority of the smallholder farmers. That is a must. There is no choice about that. And here I bring in, so I submit that agroforestry, this is an approach that can bridge the economy-ecology conflict, especially in fragile ecosystems that dominate many of the farming systems in the world, in the poorer countries. So, everybody knows what agroforestry is, but I think it is not a bad idea to mention it again. It's a purposeful growing of trees and crops, and sometimes animals in interacting combinations for multiple products and services. That interacting combination and the multiple products and services are very important components of the concept of agroforestry. In my thinking, and in the thinking of many other people who think like me, and I think there's a growing body of those sort of people, agroforestry represents an example of transforming traditional practices into robust, science-based technologies to provide answers to some of the land management problems under resource-poor conditions, okay? Agroforestry used to be sort of ridiculed as a practice in search of science, but now it has transformed itself into a science-based development in agriculture. It says the scientific foundations have been relatively well built up thanks to the past 40 years, 35 years of research on these things. So it is no longer a practice in search of science, but it's a science-based activity. Globally, it is estimated that about 1.6 billion hectares of land is under various types of agroforestry systems. Many of you may be aware of some of these agroforestry systems, but allow me to show you some examples of some of these different systems, many of which may be familiar to some of you in different parts of the world. The point I want to make here is that the so-called, quote-unquote, modern agroforestry emerged in the 1970s, particularly in the developing countries as an approach to addressing the pressing land management problems such as deforestation, land degradation, and food and fuel wood shortages. So this is how this was the genesis of a modern agroforestry. So this sort of problems with deforestation, this is a shot from Haiti where many of you work, and the fuel wood shortage, fodder shortage, these were some of the land management problems that were not addressed by the Green Revolution approaches. So people recognized the importance of these problems, and then we went around and saw that a lot of people in the world have been doing some integrated agricultural practices, combining trees and crops together on the same unit of land, and they appeared to be reasonably good and happy and contented. And so we thought, okay, why don't we think about these things instead of looking at the row cropping of same species, same preferred species? Why don't we try to learn from the farmers and what people have been doing? Is there any scientific principle involved in growing trees along with crops? So that's what led to the development, establishment and development of agroforestry. See, for example, this sort of landscape may be very familiar to some of you. This is in my thinking, it's a very beautiful landscape. You see trees and palms and rice paddies and bananas and cassava and all sorts of crops growing in intimate association. And also tall growing trees like the breadfruit and bananas and coffee and a lot of different things are grown in intimate associations. This is not the type of system that we see in industrialized agriculture. See, this is a crop building with different tiers of crop canopies and all that. Light transmission profiles in these systems have been well studied. Soil utilization patterns, nutrient utilization patterns from the soil in these different systems have been fairly well documented in a number of situations. Then the variety of products and the nutritional value they bring to the table. This sort of many of these fruits, it's very, very common to echo. See, look at the chai. This has got a lot of these fruits listed on the. So these are very well known to echo people, but they are not well known to the common man in many parts of the world. A variety of fruits and the nutritional value they bring to the table. And these are all, I just wanted to show a herd of cattle. I don't know why this slide has become shrunk, but the trees and shrubs have provided fodder for animals. Animals are a wealth with many farm families, and traditionally animals graze on trees and shrubs on farmlands, and they are seldom rest. I don't know why they got screwed up like this. So production of cattle in association with trees, what we call silvopasture. So this sort of system, this is very sort of commercially developed now in Brazil, the semi-arid parts of Minas Gerais and other places in Brazil. The silvopasture is commercial systems now. Any problem? Any idea why these slides have shrunk? This is a very well-known system that you may come across in agroforestry literature. This is the miracle tree. The earlier speaker here said he was working in Burkina Faso and Mali and all that. I'm sure he and those people who have worked in that part of the world have seen this tree. This is a so-called miracle tree, the Phytherbia albida, which sheds its leaves in the rainy season. And the tree is full of leaves in the long dry season that extends to 8-9 months a year. It's a miraculous tree, and it's the wonder tree, as we call it in agroforestry. And so there are lots of things that have been said and discussed about this particular tree. Now there is the shea tree. Now there's a lot of resurgence in the interest in the shea tree, and there is a lot of cultural and traditional social things attached to the rearing of these trees, harvesting of the trees, and you know, the women folks, you know, they harvest the nuts of the shea tree and they sing and dance along with that. It's a cultural ritual that they go through these things. It's a part of the system they depend on, they grow up with. And then large areas of semi-arid arid parts of Africa have been replanted or rejuvenated by taking care of the naturally grown Phytophthora albida trees, the so-called parkland system in West Africa, Burkina, Mali, all those countries. So growing this Phytophthora albida along with crops is a very common, it's one of the most proven technologies of agroforestry in Africa. ICRAF, the World Agroforestry Centre, has done a lot of work on this particular system, and it's being promoted on farmers' fields. And I apologize for the confusion with the slides. Now, growing perennial species like coffee, that everybody knows, coffee and tea and black pepper and all those species that are adapted to shade, growing them under shade, in the shade of trees. It's a very common agroforestry system also in many parts of the world, particularly in the highlands. We have students who have worked on these sort of systems in detailed investigations on the type of light transmission, the soil nutrient utilization. Even now we have students working on this thing, particularly in the context of carbon sequestration in soils. That is how my wife Vimala is here. She's also a professor in the University of Florida Soil and Water Science Department. We jointly undertake many of these investigations related to soil, and especially carbon sequestration in soils. And look at this sort of beautiful landscape. The tea growing areas in southern parts of India, the tree, the Grevillea robusta tree, or the so-called silver oak tree, is a very common shade tree for those tea plantations, because tea and coffee and cacao and some of these species are adapted to shade, and best quality products are obtained when they are grown under shade. And shade is provided naturally by the trees. Cacao, I just mentioned cacao. And black pepper, again, I apologize for the slight confusion. Black pepper, this vine, and then grown in a multi-story combination with the cacao, grown in lines here, along with this peach palm, those of you who have worked in Central America, you may know that peach palm Bactris is adapted only to that ecological region, that particular geographical and ecological region of Central and South America. I don't understand why it is not grown in other parts of the world. There are several species that are adapted to specific geographical regions, although there are other ecological regions in other, similar ecological regions in other parts of the world, those species are not found in those regions. This is a question that is has puzzled many ecologists, including myself, and there are no real explanation as to why these species, I'm mentioning this in the context of this peach palm. It's a very productive species, very valuable species, but it grows only in Central America and Brazil. People have tried to grow that in Hawaii, but not in Asia, not in Africa. And there are other species like that we can mention, like the durian, for example, in Asia. It's not grown in other places around the world. So several species like that, anyway. So look at this multi-strata system. This is where this is the type of system in where I started my professional career, coconut palm, with multi-story combinations of a variety of species like black pepper and bananas and all that. So this is where I began in my professional career in early 1970s. Interestingly, I'm going back to this institute where I started my career in southern part of India in Kerala. They are celebrating the centenary celebrations of initiating coconut research in India. and they are organizing a large international conference, and I'm honored to have been invited to that, both of us, and we are going there next, actually this Sunday we are leaving for that conference. And so this is the, one of the systems that I developed there, the multi-story cropping, so with the different types of combinations of species. My time is running up, so I don't want to go into more details of this thing. And these sort of systems are also developed in other parts of the world. This is a particular one. This particular one is from Brazil, the Tomiyasu area in Pará state in northeastern part of, not northeastern, but the humid tropical region of Amazon basin. And I also wanted to mention this acai is here, included here. Acai is now becoming very popular in the food nutrition industry. So what then are some of the ecosystem services of agroforestry, soil productivity, in large a lot of investigations have been conducted on the soil productivity issues related to agroforestry. What is the contribution of trees to enhancements of soil fertility? It has been pretty well documented, studied scientifically. Water quality enhancement and enhancement of degraded land reclamation. That is another ecosystem service. Biodiversity conservation and the thing that we have been working on for the past 15 years, carbon sequestration in soils. So one of the things that I want to mention about this, some of these issues like soil productivity, for example, that happens at the local level, the farm level, the plot level. When you look at the water quality enhancement, it is a little bit wider scale in the landscape level. When you look at biodiversity conservation, it's even broader, wider. And when you look at carbon sequestration and all that, it's a more global type of situation. So there are different levels at which some of these systems operate, ecosystem services operate. Now the scientific, I'm sorry. I mentioned that the scientific foundation of some of these systems has been pretty well established now, and it's all based on the most fundamental principle is what we call the niche complementarity hypothesis, which says that a larger array of species in a system leads to a broader spectrum of resource utilization and more efficient use of sharing resources, making the system more productive. This is the concept, this is the hypothesis, this is the foundation on which upon which this multi-species system operate. So the United Nations, Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, which was a very massive project that was completed in 2005. They have categorized the different ecosystem services into four: provisioning services, regulatory services, the supporting services, and social and cultural services. Agroforestry systems and these multi-species systems rank very high among all these different services and attributes. Now I also want to, this is just a distribution of the agroforestry systems worldwide. Because of the paucity of time, I'm not going to do that. I also want to introduce to you a concept of a Cinderella agroforestry system. You may wonder what is this Cinderella doing here? Well, as you know, Cinderella is a common folklore in Europe, and it has been immortalized by Walt Disney movie, the same name and all that. The point is that something and somebody, and we can use that in the conduct, we have used that in the conduct of agroforestry also, and it can be used in the conduct of other farming systems also. The point is that something or some entity that has been ignored or forgotten or bypassed, given a chance, sometimes it may come back and become very successful. That's the underlying principle of the Cinderella, right? So we can apply that to the agroforestry situation so, and other farming systems also. An agroforestry system that has been practiced for a long time, but rarely reported in literature. That is the concept of Cinderella. So recently, these examples can be found all over the world. They are an epitome of ecological sustainability and social acceptability. They have not been scientifically studied, and therefore the values are seldom quantified and recognized, just as in the case of Cinderella. And many of these systems have been criticized and denigrated in official and technical discussions for lack of the green revolution type of management prescriptions of modern systems. Excuse me. So recently we did a study on revisiting some of these the traditional systems that now we call, now I call Cinderella systems, and about 40 systems that were described in literature. I told you that many of these systems have not been adequately reported in literature, but there are some reports here and there, and about 40 of them that are that were reported in the literature from different parts of the world were studied, and we undertook a SWOT analysis, as we call strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And this paper has been published in the journal Agroforestry Systems early this year. So a qualitative assessment was done on the strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, and the analysis based on the limited reports available in literature and numerous personal communications with people who are familiar with the systems. And this is the conventional presentation of the SWOT. On the left-hand side, you find in the big column the positive things, the strengths and opportunities. On the right-hand side, there are the negative aspects of weaknesses and threats. And I have a slide of these things together. Strengths and opportunities are all those things that we talk about in terms of sustainable agriculture and development, and all those things are built in these Cinderella agroforestry systems. Sustainability, multifunctionality, niche complementarity, ecosystem services, social, cultural, and recreational values, traditional ecological knowledge, these are all ingrained, are built in these Cinderella systems. And this is the conventional versus organic. When I say conventional, that is chemical versus organic agriculture. I don't have the time to go into the details of these things, but the length of, or the size of those different radiating diagrams show the advantages of organic ecological agriculture when you compare them to commercial industrialized agriculture. So this picture here is shows the impact of Hurricane Mitch in Central America and in Honduras. The Honduran farms under monoculture had higher levels of damage in the form of mudslides in the top photo. On the bottom photo, in the neighboring biodiverse farms featuring agroforestry, contour farming, and cover crops and all that, they sustained. They persisted. They could they were resilient to these damages. So what's the take-home message that I want to present here? Traditional agricultural systems of mixed species stands, although ignored and even ridiculed in agricultural development paradigms, are still practiced by large numbers of smallholder farmers around the world. Single species systems are ecological deserts, as we call them. You know, whatever is, whether it is a tree or a crop, when you are growing them in single species, as in commercial operations of agriculture and forestry, they are ecological deserts. This is a legacy of the soil crop agriculture system, forestry systems that should not be applied to tree crop based systems. And the best strategy for climate change resilience and adaptation seems to be one of promoting multi species combinations. A holistic approach is needed. The emphasis on planning solely for one species or commodity has to give way to one that considers a crop as just one, maybe the central component, not the only one, of an ecosystem. That, that's my submission, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much for the opportunity.